Now I move to the next important aspect. What is it? Section 5. Exemption in respect of certain assets. Of course, here I will, or otherwise I love to make you to write. Because section 4 excuse is for what reason? Since already we troubled you to write it when you are listening the clubbing provisions. But section 5, at least not in toto, to the extent for the purpose of remembering, you have to write. Of course, more particularly those which are being tested many number of times in the exam, that being a senior, I'll be knowing, because this subject is being studied by me and I already wrote the exam and passed the exam and taught many number of times. So write with giving due respects to the experience. Okay, listen first and then you can write. Many a time whenever I make you to write, friends, more than your hands, my hands are getting pained, because I love you the most. Right. Now, listen the point here, that is, exemption in respect of certain assets, what is it? A property is held by a trust or other legal obligation for any public purpose of a charitable or religious nature in India. There is a trust established for charitable and religious purpose. Its activities should be in India. If the assets are there, they are used for the purpose of charitable or religious outside India, no, then they are not exempted. They are to be included only. So, for a trust established for charitable or religious purpose, which purpose is confined to India, such assets used for charitable or religious purpose in India are being exempted is a point. Similarly, a member is there of a HUF. Member is there for the HUF. HUF is already a taxable entity. In respect of its assets, already it is offering the wealth. So, individual interest of a member in the wealth of the HUF, it is being exempted. Then, jewelry in possession of any ruler, that is heirloom jewelry, then it is also to be exempted as a point. Now, what is most important from the examination point of view is non-residents. Non-residents, they come here, bring the assets, bring the money, then all that is being exempted for prescribed number of years. All what assets which they acquire just 1 year before their coming or after their coming, out of the monies which they brought, in case if they are purchasing, then they all get exempted. They all get exempted is a point. For how long they are going to be get exempted? For 7 successive assessment years commencing from the assessment year next following the date on which such person returned is a point. So this is one aspect many a time in the exam they asked. So please do write the important thing. In case that is exempted assets, in case of an SSC, in case of an SSC, being an individual and a citizen of India, and a citizen of India, or a person of Indian origin, or a person of Indian origin, who was ordinarily residing in a foreign country, who was ordinarily residing in a foreign country that is non-resident, and return to India, and return to India with a intention to, with a intention to permanently reside in India, with a intention to permanently reside in India, then the money and assets, then the money and the assets brought by him into India and the value of assets acquired by him, the value of assets acquired by him out of monies sent from abroad, out of monies sent from abroad, and from NRE account within one year immediately preceding the date of his return to India. Number second point, the value of any assets acquired at any time, on or after the date of his return to India, on or after the date of his return to India, out of the monies brought from abroad, or out of the balance in the NRE account, or out of the balance in NRE account, standing on the date of his return to India, shall be exempted for a period of 7 successive assessment years. Commencing with the assessment year next following the date on which he returned to India. See, it appears to be very simple, but a lot to be read out of it. Kerala High Court judgment, just listen, that's enough. Even if the SC has converted the assets which were originally brought by him from outside into money and has used that money for acquiring other assets, the asset which is acquired with the sale consideration of the original asset is also eligible for exemption. So I am a non-resident who is residing permanently outside India. I came to India to permanently settle down in India. I brought one asset and sold that particular asset and purchased one more asset. Even that asset also will be eligible for exemption is what they say. But please do remember here, let us suppose I am a non-resident who is permanently residing outside India. I am going on sending my money to my father who purchased a house property in 2008. Now I am coming to India and making sale of that particular house and purchasing another property. Will that property get exempted? The answer is, if at all you are coming into India, all the assets which you acquired just 1 year before you are coming here, they only will be eligible for, what is it, your exemption. You can come with assets from the foreign country, cash with from the foreign country, and can acquire the assets out of that cash or the assets. But not that you sent money to your father who purchased for you some assets prior to 1 year before you are coming. Such assets, the exemption we are not prescribing here. See, all this can be well understood by doing a particular example where 10 points are there. See, Mr. X, an Indian citizen ordinarily residing in UK, returned to India on 1/1/2011. When he returned, keep it in the mind, what is the date of his return? 1/1/2011. And gives you the following information. On 30/6/2009, he sent 20 lakhs to India, out of which gold was purchased. 30/6/2009, and your date of coming is what? 1/1/2011. 1/1/2011 say, what is it? 1 year means what? 1/1/2010. Whereas this date is what? 30/6/2009. 30/6/2009 means before 1 year, not within 1 year from the date of the arrival. Within 1 year before the date of arrival is not the point. So on that pretext, what we say, taxable since gold purchased more than 1 year prior to the date of the return. So make a note of this point, that is, assets purchased more than one year from the date of return are to be treated as assets. And will be included in the net wealth. Then friends, the problem is, let us suppose, instead of gold, let us suppose the purchased asset happens to be house property. If it is a house property, still it is to be treated as an asset. Of course, as we proceed in this particular topic, we are going to study one house property is going to be given exemption. Unless and otherwise, he claims there's such an exemption under this particular clause, there is no exemption, whether it is a jewelry or house property. It won't make any difference. once it is purchased for a period of more than 1 year before his coming, then it is to be treated as an asset. On 30th 6 2010, he acquired gold by selling ancestral property in India. This is not out of the money which he earned outside. There is an ancestral property for him. He sold that particular ancestral property and purchased a house property, or purchased the gold. Then it is taxable, since it is not purchased out of the, what is it, foreign money. This exemption, what we are saying, is only with respect to the assets acquired out of the foreign money. Then on 4-7-2010, he purchased jewelry out of his NRE account in New Delhi. 4-7-2010 means it is well within 1 year before his coming. So all assets which are acquired from the NRE account just 1 year before the date of his arrival will get exempted. Suppose he purchases a jewelry on 4-7-2009, bole to more than 1 year before, then it is to be treated as an asset. Then he purchased motor cars for 30 lakhs on 28-3-2012. After his arrival, out of the monies he brought or out of the balance in the NRE account, if he is purchasing, then for 7 years from the date of his arrival, next following assessment year, 7 years, it is being exempted. Then friends, his NRE account was converted into NRO account and he purchased a helicopter out of the NRO account. What we say? You can make sale of the assets which you brought and you can purchase another asset. So NRE account, NRO account pe convert hoke, unse paise leke aap helicopter kharid liye to kya hoga? That is, exemption of 5-5 is not available for the assets purchased out of the sale proceeds of the assets acquired from foreign funds. Therefore, exemption under 5-5 is not available in respect of jewelry. See, the whole lot of point here is, like, in the case if he is purchasing the jewelry out of his NRE account in New Delhi, it is being exempted. Jewelry is purchased on 4-7-2009, then 1 year before, it's not being exempted. And then he purchased motor cars for 30 lakhs out of the money brought from UK and deposited in his savings bank account. Out of the monies which he brought, subsequently if he purchases, there is no problem. It is going to be well exempted. And as far as your NRE account converted into NRO account and purchasing helicopter, it is being exempted, not a problem. And money is brought from outside, he purchased the shares, shares are not assets, so the question of inclusion does not arise. He imported motor cars to India, while back to India, imported motor cars are sold and jewelry is purchased out of the assets which he brought. If he makes a sale and again purchases another asset, exemption is available. Who said so? Kerala High Court in K.O. Matthews case, they said. So like this, you have to be very careful. And here it is stated, out of the monies brought from abroad, he purchased a house property on 21-6-2011. The house property is sold and out of the sale proceeds, jewelry is purchased as on 31-3-2012. Here there is a point. That is, out of the monies brought, he purchased an asset. That asset is very well gets exempted. But that asset is sold and another asset is purchased. There what we say, 5-5 exemption is not available. If he brings an asset and makes sale of that asset and purchases one asset, it's okay. That purchased asset, if he, again he makes sale and purchases one more asset, for that your 5-5 exemption is not available. Write down this particular point. Exemption under section 5-5 is available for the assets
He is available for the assets purchased out of sale proceeds of assets brought into India. Next point. Exemption under 5(5) is not available. Exemption under section 5(5) is not available for assets purchased out of sale proceeds of assets acquired from foreign funds. See, this point you should first feel it for remembering it forever. Otherwise, undigested food, how dangerous it is for the stomach. Undigested knowledge is also dangerous to the brain. Try to understand. What is it? Main kya bata rahe hain aapko? Asset you brought from foreign country and sold that asset and acquired another asset. Very well, exemption is there. After you came here using the foreign funds, you purchased one asset and then you sold that asset and purchased another asset. There is a marked distinction. That is, in first case, asset which you brought from outside, if you make sale and acquires another asset, it will qualify for exemption. Whereas, after you come here, you purchased one asset out of the foreign funds, that is an exempted asset. But that exempted asset, you are making sale and acquiring another asset, then not possible. That means, asset acquired out of sale proceeds of another asset gets exempted when? Only when that is an asset brought from outside. The asset sold by you must be the asset which is brought from outside, not the asset which you acquired in India. If that gets sold and you are investing your money in another asset, the exemption is not prescribed. So to this detail, as a final student, you should be very careful. Probably this much of the detail is not required if this subject is being put for your PCC or in some other sister professional courses, CWA and CS. I found this particular paper being there at their interstage. There probably this much of the detailed knowledge is not required, but this is the first and the last time as a student you will be studying the wealth tax once it comes to the point of the CA. So this requires keen observation to this extent. Then I move to the next exemption which is prescribed. This is also many times repeated in the exam. That is exemption under section 5(6) in respect of one house or a part of the house or a plot of land. If it is a plot of land, it should be less than 500 square meters or less than 500 square meters. Then one house or plot less than 500 square meters. 500 or less than 500 square meters, it gets exempted. And this exemption is only for the individuals and the HFs. Write down, friends. Exemption under 5 clause 6. Shall be allowed in case of individual and HF in respect of number one house or part of the house. One house or part of the house, and then or number two, plot of land of 500 square meters of 500 square meters or less. Be careful. Either of this, not that one plot and one house I will take the exemption under 5 clause 6 is not the point. See, exemption under 5 clause 6 is available for any house, whether it could be a residential house or a commercial house, whether it is let out or self occupied. Residential house let out for 300 days or more, anyhow trade exemption is there, so there is no need for bringing them into 5 clause 6. First try to understand, friends, under the income tax law also we have studied, for a particular income to be exempted, first it should be income. First it is an income, then only the question of exemption comes. There is no need to look at whether exemption is there for a particular receipt which is not at all an income. So like that only, when you studied the assets, residential house let out for 300 or more than 300 days is not an asset. There is no question of claiming any exemption in respect of a thing which is not an asset. So this is an additional one. Once that residential or commercial property is an asset, then in respect of such kind of assets, one house property you can claim the exemption is what you have to understand. Anyhow, once we start doing the problems, you get how to see the practicality of this. See, any house property used for the purpose of the business or profession is not an asset. So in respect of a thing which is not an asset, don't claim the exemption under 5 clause 6. Again and again, we are moving around the same point. For you to claim the exemption under 5 clause 6, necessary thing is that it must be an asset first of all. Then only the question of your claiming the exemption. I am not making you to write, because you are going to write this once you start doing the problems. Then friends, see here, for just making you to understand, Mr. A has got the following house properties. House X is valued at 50 lakhs. House Y is valued at 200 lakhs. House Z is valued at 10 lakhs. He is also having a plot of land Q measuring 1000 square meters valued at 500 lakhs. Another plot of land measuring 400 square meters valued at 250 lakhs. You advise the client which asset he should claim 5 clause 6. Naturally, any asset whose value is more, but it should again fit into the, what is it, this 5 clause 6. Land whose area is less than 500 or less than 500, so that is 250 lakhs, so you advise them to claim that 250 lakhs property. Why not 500 lakhs? Because that land is more than 1000 square meters. Why not the other house properties? Those house properties are less than this particular plot of land of 400 square meters, its value being 250 lakhs. So always advantage should come to the SSC, and you should be careful. Like such questions in the exam they are asking. Chalo. Then debts. We are only moving around that net wealth concept. What I covered? I covered what is an asset, what is a deemed asset, what is exemption. Now I am moving to reduction of debts incurred for the purpose of assets which are included in the net wealth. When I say debt, friends, please do remember, my income tax liability is not a debt. Just like under the income tax law, income tax paid is not an allowable expenditure. So now if I say that is an income tax liability, it is not a debt owed. Now another beautiful example. These are all to make you to understand the subject. Beautiful way of presentation. SSC has a gold valued at rupees 10 lakhs. He takes a loan of 8 lakhs against the security of the gold and invests that 8 lakhs in the shares. and his other assets are 50 lakhs. First, try to understand, friends. If you take a loan and acquire an asset, then that debt will be deducted. Not that against a particular asset you mortgage it and take a loan and use it for other purposes. Then no deduction. Yes, you acquired the shares by borrowing the money, but shares are not the assets. So here, how do you calculate the net worth? Gold 10 lakhs, other assets 50 lakhs, shares are not assets, 60 lakhs, and debt will not be allowed. Because debt is not incurred for the purpose of acquiring the assets which are included in the assets definition. Then another question. SC takes a loan from the bank 5 lakhs and purchases motor cars of 5 lakhs and his other assets are 50 lakhs. Then how do you go about? Other assets 50 lakhs, motor car 5 lakhs, put together 55 lakhs, less exemption, less debt of 5 lakhs, balance is 50 lakhs, up to 30 lakhs no tax, on that 20 lakhs, 1% is how much? 20,000. Wealth tax, is it a liability? No. Income tax and wealth tax are not debts to be deducted. Another question here. Mr. X owns a house property valued 1 crore. He has taken a loan of 75 lakhs for purchasing the said house property and his other assets are 50 lakhs. Other assets 50 lakhs, house property 1 crore. But one house property, they can claim the exemption under 5 clause 6. So value is taken as nil. So no debt will be allowed to be deducted. Why? Once asset is not included in the wealth, the question of related debt being deducted does not arise. So what is a wealth tax obligation? On that 50 lakhs up to 30 lakhs, no amount, and on remaining 20 lakhs, 1%, 20,000. Another question. There are two houses for an individual. One house is valued 20 lakhs, loan to acquire that asset is 5 lakhs. Another house value 30 lakhs and the loan taken is 28 lakhs. Which you claim the exemption? Already for 30 lakhs, 28 lakhs of the loan is there. So the net effect is what? Only 2 lakhs. If I take the first thing as exemption, what will happen? 20 lakhs minus 5 lakhs, 15 lakhs. Which I always feel, 15 lakhs only I will include it in my assets, and the one with the lesser amount I will not include it in my assets. Because exemption, if I want to claim, I will try to claim the asset which has got more value. My 30 lakhs house has got already loan taken for acquiring that asset, 28 lakhs. So if it is included in my assets, only 2 lakhs will be my value of the wealth. So that happy well, I can claim the exemption of that 20 lakhs property on which loan is only 5 lakhs. So 20 lakhs minus 5 lakhs is 15 lakhs. So I always prefer to claim that particular asset as a exemption under 5 clause 6. And the other asset, I am going to take the help of the debt being reduced. So in the example, what we say, his other assets are 50 lakhs. The asset which he acquired with 20 lakhs against which loan is 5 lakhs is there, that I will claim exemption under 5 clause 6. And another asset I will include 30 lakhs, but from that the debt portion 28 lakhs I am going to reduce, so that my total wealth becomes 52 lakhs, up to 30 lakhs no amount, and on 22 lakhs 1% happens to be 22,000. Then friends, like that you have to be very clear. Here another good example. SC purchased a gold of 10 lakhs by taking a loan of 10 lakhs. The schedule 3 value of the gold, let us suppose, say 11 lakhs in one situation, 9 lakhs in another situation. See, his other assets are 50 lakhs. So situation 1, if I look at, other assets are 50 lakhs, market value of the gold is 11 lakhs, total 61 lakhs, out of that the debt is 10 lakhs. If I reduce, the wealth becomes 51 lakhs. Whereas in another situation where market value, schedule 3 value is 9 lakhs, 50 lakhs is other assets, 9 lakhs is the gold value, 59 lakhs less the debt, 10 lakhs. so that my net wealth becomes 49 lakhs. On that, I have to pay 19,000 rupees of the wealth tax. Here, most important, you have to remember with this example is, the debt is not restricted up to the value of the assets. Let us suppose that I purchased an asset with 10 lakhs, but its value is coming down to now 9 lakhs. From 9 lakhs, this 10 lakhs, if I reduce, 1 lakhs of extra amount will be there, that will be deducted from my other assets. All these points, when we sit in the exam, we get lot of doubts. Is it that their exemption is to be restricted up to the income, debt is it to be reduced up to the amount of the asset value? No. Even if your debt is more, that higher amount only will be allowed to be deducted. So these are the aspects which you should remember, and I am not troubling you more. Good number of books are there for you to work out on this. Of course, good number of problems we are going to do in the next sessions to follow, to do with the, what is it, clear understanding of wealth tax from the CA final examination point of view, the discussion on suggested previous questions. Friends, I move to the next issue, section 6, exclusion of the assets and debts outside India. Yes, for a resident and ordinarily resident, what we studied there in the income tax, global income is taxable. Like that, for resident and ordinarily resident, global wealth is taxable. But for non-resident, his assets which are located in foreign country are not to be included under the wealth tax in India. So once assets are not included, even the, what is it, liabilities, debts incurred to acquire those assets also will not be allowed to be deducted. This is what your section 6 says. What is the section 6 deals with? Exclusion of the assets and debts outside India as a point. With that, I am concluding this session. This session is on aspects of what is a chargeability, who are not considered as SSEs, what is an asset, what is a deemed asset, what are the important exemptions, and then deduction for the debt incurred to acquire the assets which are included in the net wealth. Then finally section 6, that is in respect of the properties located outside India, assets located outside India, and debts incurred to acquire those assets in case of non-residents, since those assets are not included, even the debts are also not allowed to be deducted. This is one aspect, and the next aspect is a mega aspect, because you have to carefully learn the procedure. This is not law. Wealth tax, the next session is more of a procedure. How do you value? In that valuation, the biggest situation is valuation of immovable property. Then of course rest of the things are very simple, and remaining aspects of what is it, income tax vis-a-vis your wealth tax provisions, that we will discuss, and special provisions on liability under different circumstances we will take up. Before I conclude, let me tell you, see, under the income tax law we studied one point, when clubbing happens, if the transferor is unable to pay the tax, then the tax can be well recovered from the transferee. Like that, even under the wealth tax law also, if the transferor is not in a position to pay the wealth tax, then although the asset is clubbed in the hands of the transferor, in wealth tax authorities also can very well recover that particular tax from the, what is it, the transferee is a point. Thank you.